Okay, well, I guess it's time for me to explain everything in this game, starting with the friends. So, this is Butters. He's a wimp, as you can see. He's a lovable child who's extremely naive of the world and thinks only positive. He is based on someone Matt and Trey work with. What's his name? God damn it. Okay, his name is Eric Stout, the guy Butters is based on. And basically, Matt and Trey constantly make fun of him and say that he talks exactly like Butters. Which, it's sort of not true because I actually heard him on the movie commentary. And he doesn't exactly sound like that. Now, Butters has gone through a lot through these seasons. Matt and Trey especially love the episodes with just him and Cartman because opposites when they are brought together make the best of shows. They're very funny. They're great. He's gone through a lot, you know. He was first introduced as Butter because that kid was there before, but he wasn't named Butters. But Butters appeared first in the trilogy, the Meteor Shower trilogy, back in season 3, in the episode entitled what was it called? Two Men in a Hot Tub, I think. Yeah, where basically they ripped off the Branch Davidians incident where the Waco siege, where basically the police kind of the ATF kind of fucked it up and killed all of the people in all the people in including kids, which by the way is bullshit. That siege was fucking useless, and they really really fucked up. But yeah, since then Butters has become one of their favorite characters apparently, and also kind of a fan favorite. Next up, Keeney. Princess Keeney. Of course his trademark is that he dies in well, he used to die in every episode, now not so much. Just from time to time when Matt and Trey feel like it. He's based on the poor kid in the group. Basically, this idea of the four boys came to them like this. Basically, yeah, in a group you basically have the two best friends. Those are Kyle and Stan, the fat one, of course, Carmen, and the poor one, like Kenny, who would do anything for money. Now, the fact that you can't understand what he's saying is actually quite sweet because if you kind of get his language thing, then you can hear him say a lot of shit, which would have been censored. Especially he tells dirty jokes, which nobody of course understands except. Except those who really get the way this character speaks. Of course, in the first 7, 8, 9 seasons, he died in every episode. Oh my God, they killed Kane! You bastards! That's pretty much it. Nothing else to say about him. He's kind of a side character. He can't carry a storyline all by himself because he can't freaking speak. Oh yeah, and there's Scott Malkinson, who has the power of diabetes. I don't know much about him except that he has diabetes, and that's his whole joke. Basically, all the jokes, most of the jokes related to Kenny is that he's poor. Mrs. Cartman, called Leanne, is a mom who actually looks quite worried in this picture. Okay, so apparently she's a slut, of course. Basically, the whole town has slept with her. We thought she was a hermaphrodite for the longest time, but since season 13 or 14, it has been revealed that no, she actually is a woman. Well, fucking duh. She raises her son as a friend. I mean, she acts towards her son as a friend and not like a son, you know, without authority, and that's why Carmen is basically a little shithead. So it's all thanks to her. Thank you, Miss Carmen, for giving us Eric, such a fine young boy. Dougie, this kid also first appeared in the same episode as Butters did. He was a nerd. Well, still is a nerd. A nerd. Basically, what can I say about him? Yeah, he was a nerd, and then he basically became good friends with Butters when he became Professor Chaos, and he became General Disarray. And that's pretty much all that I know of him. Nothing more to say. Kate Gardner, I actually don't know anything about her, but because she hasn't been on the show, or if she has, then very small parts. Pete also is a new character. Romper Stomper actually appeared in Cartman Silly Hate Crime 2000, which was in season 4, I think. 4 or 5? No, it was 4. It was 4, that was at the beginning of 2000. Yeah. Basically, in it, Cartman committed a hate crime towards Token Black. This guy. He threw a rock at him, and basically he was convicted to Juvie Hall for a few years. And basically there he met this kid, Romper Stomper. And basically they became, well, not friends, but Romper Stomper told him that he would told Cartman that he would help him escape if he got him some shit, you know, like cigarettes or then a game. And basically, Cartman would hide that shit up his ass, and then he would basically shit the thing into the toilet and then give it to Romper Stomper. His favorite dream was going to Disneyland. And at the end of the episode, basically, Cartman comes in to visit, you know, after he's been released. He comes in and basically he starts shitting Disneyland, basically the rides, which is one of the more surreal things ever to happen. I mean, shitting Disneyland, goddamn. That's pretty much it. Basically, in that episode, the theme when Carmen goes to jail is basically the music from Oz. Another interesting thing. And also about that episode, hate crimes are silly. Because all crimes are basically hate crimes. And if you so basically if you kill a guy and he's the same color as you, then okay, you get a sentencing. If you kill a guy who's not your race, you get a larger sentencing. What the fuck is that? I mean, seriously, a death is a death, or a crime is a crime. This is real racism. You see, this is real racism because it's inequality. If all people were really equal, then hate crime shouldn't exist. Okay? That's the basic premise. But enough about hate crimes. Annie, I don't know. She's in this game and she helps us a lot. Mrs. Biggle, I'm not sure who she is, to be honest. Officer Barbrady, basically, his voice was modeled after someone Matt Train knew who actually spoke like this in this bombastic voice. His first appearance was actually the very first episode, and basically his joke is nothing to see here, move along, you know, when obviously shit is going down, like for example a freaking UFO crash, you know, like move on people, nothing to see here. He learned to read, but then he read Ayn Rand's Atlas Shrugged, and then gave up on reading. Which I don't know why. Even though I haven't read it, I don't think that it's as bad as Barre would think, you know, because I happen to be slightly libertarian in thought. It appeals to me anyway. Barbrady, he, I don't know, he had sex with the mayor. That's why I know. Basically, Matt and Trey have said that everyone in South Park had sex with everyone else. So, you know, sort of a fun little town where everyone fucks everyone else. Literally. Okay. Millie, another new character. Al Gore, of course, based on the real Al Gore. Basically, they made him seem pathetic in this game, and in reality, Al Gore is kind of pathetic, to be honest. Other things, of course, he first appeared in the episode entitled Man Bear Pig, back in season 10, I think. And basically, yeah, that's kind of it for him. Matt and Trey have said that it's bullshit that that Al Gore won for best documentary for An Uncomfortable Truth, because as they rightfully said, that's not a fucking king documentary. That's a PowerPoint presentation about what you believe. When a documentary is supposed to be about a human condition or some other thing. That was just a preach-o-rama, you know? That shouldn't count. He won a fucking Oscar and the fucking Nobel Peace Prize. He didn't fucking deserve them. That's kind of for Al Gore. Fuck him. Mr. Kim, he first appeared in I don't quite remember the episode, but anyway, it was this simple joke where basically he couldn't say city, so he said shitty. Shiwa, take our praise, and that's the whole joke. So basically, actually no, I think he first appeared in Child Abduction Is Not Funny, where basically the whole town became frightened that that children could get abducted. So first they installed a Child Tracker 2000 of them, you know, which was this massive helm which was inconvenient. But then they found out that outsiders could abduct your kids, so they went to Mr. Kim to build a Great Wall of South Park, which he did, which was of which prompted the first appearance of the Mongolians, of course, who, you know, started to break down the Great Wall of China of South Park. Basically at the end, you know, they. The parents learned that most of the time children get abducted by someone they know, and then they basically stop interacting with the other people in town. And they find out that people that so, that most of the time when kidnappings happen, it's one of the parents. So parents start suspecting each other, and then basically to protect the kids from themselves, they prompt them to leave town, and basically they go to the Mongolians, and together they break down the wall of South Park, and everybody learns a lesson, and it's all good. And Mr. Kim basically is pissed off that he built the giant wall for nothing. Skeeter. Skeeter. What can I say about Skeeter? He's the guy who owns the bar, Skeeter's bar, and basically his whole joke for some time was that Was it him or was it someone else? Yeah, it was him. Basically, he first appeared, I think, in the sexual in the episode Sexual Harassment Panda, when basically people were entering and he was saying, "Hey, we don't take kindly to your type around here." So basically, when the kids said, "Hey, we don't take kindly to you kids around here. No, let me say something. How is it that you kids don't pay any tax or something like that?" Or, "Hey, we don't take kindly to panda bears around here. You know, what is it with panda bears? I mean, they eat bamboo, and yet they live in places in China where bamboo can be found or shit like that. You know, that's basically that was basically his whole joke for the longest time." And then this guy, the bartender, would say, "Now, Skeeter, he ain't doing anything or something." And that's all I know about these two. Mr. McCormick, Kenny's dad. He's basically white trash, you know, can't hold a job, doesn't provide for his family, shit like that. He was school buddies with Carl's dad, you know. That's pretty much it. I don't know what else to say about him. In the Nambla episode, he basically gets his balls crushed and shit like that. Basically, he can take a lot of pain and not die because you know it kind of runs in the family with Kenny. Token Black, voiced by Adrian Beard. So, firstly, how was Token born? Basically, they needed a black kid for the hate crime episode. So they looked around the office and said, who should be Token? I wonder who. Adrian, yeah, because Adrian Beer was the only black guy working. And so they said, oh, Adrian, yeah, you're black. That's yeah, and that's why Token Black has that voice. It's basically. Most of the kids in South Park are voiced by, well, most characters in South Park are voiced by either Matt Stone or Trey Parker, but Token is different because he's voiced by Adrian Beard, who is I don't know exactly, maybe storyboard, I'm not very sure. That's kind of it for Token. He's rich. His parents are wealthy. They're upper middle class. Way upper middle class. Mr. Slave, he was brought in season six, I think. When basically Mr. Garrison had to wanted to get fired for being gay, so that then he could sue the school. I think the episode was Death Camp of Tolerance. And basically in that episode, Mr. Slave was introduced, but also Lemmy, who was a gerbil. And basically, Mr. Slave shoves Lemmy Wins up his ass. And thus the adventure which you've witnessed in this LP began, you know, because we were basically in Lemmy Wins' shoes. Lemmy Wins actually meets the Sparrow Prince, you know, the Frog King, the Katata fish, you know, these guys. So that's cool. And of course, he's ripping off Frodo. Let me whisk. Mr. Slave is just Mr. Slave. He's perverted to the extreme, and he loves it. And he's married to Big Gay Al. So yeah. Francis, I don't know. Mrs. McCormick. Basically, she gave birth to Kenny about 49 times at one point. Basically, there is a Cthulhu mythos going around, you know, from the Coon and Friends trilogy. Basically, it works something like this: Kenny is somehow connected to Cthulhu because there is something in the Cthulhu book about that which sleeps can never die, and basically Kenny can't die. He basically whenever he dies, Mrs. McCormick kind of gives birth to him again, and so and basically everyone else's memory gets erased about the fact that he died, except for him. So he knows that he's died, like 15,000 times since the show began. Tweek. He was first introduced in the Underpants Gnomes episode back in season 2. Basically, as you saw, his father owns a coffee shop. And yeah, he's basically he's basically afraid to not disappoint. His trademark thing is that little scream he does, and oh man, they're gonna get me, they're gonna get me, or something like that. He's all the time high on coffee. That's basically it for Tweek, I guess. I think I will end today's part with Kevin Stoley. Basically, Kevin was introduced as that one kid who basically played something else and couldn't fit in. So for example, during the episode Return of the Fellowship of the Ring to the Two Towers video store, he basically came to the meeting as a stormtrooper. And he said, "Yeah, we must stop the rebellion." And basically, the whole point of Kevin Stoley is this one joke. It's like what Karen said, "Kevin, god damn it, we're playing our game, and then you come in and ruin it all." So basically, Kevin is there just to ruin the game for them. Just take them out of the atmosphere by coming as a Vulcan or as a stormtrooper or something like that, which gives Cartman a chance to say, "Kevin, god damn it, god damn it, Kevin. For fuck's sake, Kevin. Seriously." And that's it for the Encyclopedia Park for today. See you next time when we will continue with Jesus, this guy, and other guys. Bye.